with a lecture series which the college had initiated. Before we begin, I would be honored to introduce our dignitaries for today. Shri Ashish Mishraji, who will be joining us shortly, a dynamic personality who has taken the Institute to newer heights with his vision and acceptance to new ideas and ventures. The efforts taken by him are outstanding and has shaped our organization to what it is today. The tireless efforts and always ready to help attitude has put the Institute on a social and educational platform. Architect Rituraj Parekh, our guest of honor for today, is a practicing architect with vivid experience and has been working in Goa. He is also a designer and design publisher with keen interest in all things quintessentially Indian. Shri Gurunath Dalvi, our mentor and practicing architect for more than 40 years, needs no introduction. He has done considerable amount of work in the fields of architectural education, not only as a teacher, but also as an institutional head, advisor, and governing council member of various colleges. He is an inspiration for all and a recipient of many more awards. For certain unavoidable circumstances, he has not been able to join to us. Principal Architect Rita Nayak, loved by one and all here, an architect and urban planner with over 25 years of working experience in architecture and construction industry. She has worked on urban aspects like community-based public spaces and slum mapping and has been contributing enthusiastically in architectural design for senior classes and also contributing as research guide and mentor for the final year students. We also have amongst us Architect Tripti Biswas, who has done her master's in urban design. With over 20 years of professional practice in large-scale architectural, interiors, commercial, corporate and hospitality projects, she has been in the teaching fraternity for more than 8 years and has her valuable research and contributions to urban design. Now, before we kickstart this function, I would invite Architect Rita Nayak, who would give a gist of this program and the very purpose of this event, calling upon Architect Rita Nayak.
Good morning, all. Before I start, let me congratulate my second year students who's done a wonderful job and the entire team of college project for, you know, making this possible. Architect Charles Correa, an eminent urban planner, is particularly noted for his sensitivity to the needs of the urban poor and for his use of traditional methods and materials. His demise was a huge loss to the architectural fraternity of India and global. As a person in whom they sought answers for architectural design, and urban planning, he was elemental in portraying the language and identity of Indian architecture in the backdrop of dominance of international styles. His work will remain in the memory of all Mumbaikers and will always inspire the generations to come. In memory of the renowned architect, we at Aditya College started a yearly memorial lecture series where renowned architects deliver lectures in the college, share their experience of their working with the legendary architect today. We have gathered also to celebrate the achievements of our students, but also to give due regard to our values and morals, which these awardees exemplify, like discipline, compassion, and zeal for learning. Since the awards are a way to encourage multidisciplinary approach that the college carries and inculcate competitive spirit, our college organizes the ceremony every year to encourage their students who have done exceptionally well in their architectural design projects and thesis in the third and the final year, respectively. I further ask my team to continue with the program. Thank you.
Before we begin this felicitation and learning experience, I, on behalf of the entire students, would like to thank our guest of honor, Architect Rituraj Parekh, for taking out his precious time and gracing the occasion with his presence. I will call upon Architect Rita Nayak to welcome Architect Ruturaj Parekh. I would also take upon to call all the dignitaries on the dais to please be a part of the lamp lighting ceremony and we further start the function. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Our distinguished guest of honor today is Architect Ruturaj Parekh, who is the founder and director at Matto, an architecture, design, and publishing firm based in Goa. His work at Matto deals with architecture and curatorial projects with the idea of diversity and richness of the Indian landscape at the core of the practice. He is the former director of the Charles Correia Foundation, where he led research and public forum initiatives. Ruturaj was an editor at Architect and Builder magazine from 2010 to 2014. As an architectural firm, Matto has worked on small and large residential, commercial, institutional, and civic projects in India with a keen interest in the design of contextually appropriate built environments. The curatorial work of Matto includes research and publication of contemporary works from India on thinkmatto.in, a critical review of projects titled The Merit List, a biannual journal on architecture and design titled Inside, and a range of editorial projects that include books, seminars, and a national conference titled Frame. Without any further delay, may I please welcome Architect Ruturaj Parekh and request him to begin the presentation.
Good morning. Can you hear me at the back? Yeah, okay. Thank you all for having me. It's the first time I am presenting what I think is the significance of Charles Collier's work. I have done that before as a speech, is more of a sort of read lecture, but this is the first time I am working on. I mean, I'm presenting it as a series of images. Some of these drawings are from the archives of the Charles Collier Foundation, from his archives. So a lot of it is not even in the public domain. So you'll see a lot of new, previously unseen work. But before I start, I want to thank all of you to be here with me today. It's a very special moment for me personally to be presenting his work, and this talk, while I was preparing it, gave me an opportunity to reflect on a lot of things, a lot of ideas that I think are very essential to understand Charles Collier. So I don't want to per se present his work, but I want to kind of outline some core. I want to outline some very core ideas that I think outline his career. I also feel that without discussing ideas, his work seems to be isolated. So there's this very rich layer of concerns and issues that he was dealing with as a part of his practice, as a part of his that can only be foregrounded if. So I am imagining that we have students from the first year all the way up here, so I'll keep it as simple as I can, and I thank you all for this opportunity. It's very special for me. I think the architects who worked in the early times after independence, or let's say the modernists who define the post-independence era in some way, were deeply influenced by the freedom movement. And it was not just because the freedom movement was had an overreaching influence on them. It is also because of the very special way that we earned our independence with principles such as non-violence, with mass movements of self-reliance, with great emphasis on ideas which deal with industry, and they were all at the dawn of that time, in the early times after independence, looking at a very different India, an India which was sort of still living in its villages, in India which was also deeply philosophical, an India which was divided by the partition, so the wounds of the partition were fresh, an India which was incredibly diverse, which we continue to be, in terms of our religions, languages, food, culture, society, economy, etc. So this is the first Constituent Assembly being addressed by Jawaharlal Nehru. You can see a lot of political stalwarts in the. I think there's something wrong with the. Yeah, so I think self-resolving. Yeah, it's done. So yeah, this is the first. So you can see the kind of. I feel that this sense of India, or the nation-building project, let's say, influenced a lot of people, not just architects, artists, musicians, filmmakers like Satyajit Ray, people like Ambedkar, Tagore, people who were kind of direct recipients of this legacy, let's say the first generation of new politicians in India. And the, of course, the first generation of architects, Korea, Raj Rewal, Achyut Kanwinde, Balkrishna Doshi, people like them. And this image is very emblematic of the kind of democracy we are, you know. It's, we are a messy, very sort of difficult democracy. We almost impossible to build consensus across, and that is also a great strength that we have, you know, that all the more aggressive or ruthless sort of political moves have kind of been buffered by the very nature of what we are. And I think people like Korea were very aware of this idea of India, let's say, and they wanted to contribute to that national building project. So they had this amazing idea of a big cultural project that they wanted to be a part of. So yeah, here are the three ideas of India as I imagine. The first one is Gandhi's idea of India, an India which is in its villages, the India which is self-reliant, an India which is proud and takes pride in its simplicity and its culture and its frugality, and the way we as Indians must sort of remember that while we sit in this wonderful air-conditioned hall, half of our country still has to look forward to a day where there is no guarantee of food by the end of it. So there is a huge disconnect or sort of contradiction in the way we imagine our country. The second is Nehru's way of looking at India. And in early India, I believe Nehru had this. Nehru was instrumental in restoring the pride that we have as Indians through his large institutional projects. I mean, some of the best institutions in the country, the IITs, the IIMs, the Atomic Research Center, all of them were Nehruvian projects. You know, he was very close to people like Homi Bhabha, that you all know, the TIS, FR Tata Institute of Fundamental Research here in Bombay. The Indian Institute of Science is one of the best in the world. All were set up in this short time, you know, after independence. Because I think Nehru believed that institutions in any country will help keep the fundamental ethos or values of that nation intact. And the third is the Tagore's idea of India. And Tagore's idea of India was very different. It was deeply philosophical. Strangely, Tagore was one of the rare intellectuals who could talk to people. You know, if you ask a common man, he would know about Tagore. He would be able to recite one of his poems. He would be able to understand what he's saying, in spite of him being extremely complex and intellectual in this sense. So these are the three ideas that we will sort of discuss as we discuss Charles Collier's work. That's Nehru with Corbusier. That's Balkrishna Doshi and Corbusier on the site of the Milonas building in Ahmedabad. You can see the shuttering is just off. It's a beautiful image, these two. You know, on one hand, this idea of nation building, and on the other hand, building iconic projects in India. The Charkha is a fantastic symbol of both self-reliance and independence. You know, I mean, it Gandhi made it into a symbol for the nation because he knew that the values which are associated with it, and it continues to sort of defy our culture still. So one of Charles Collier's first projects was to design for this screen is doing some tricks with the image, but one of his first projects was to design. Achyut Kanwinde and Jane Drew were in the jury, and it was a competition to design the Gandhi Smarak Sangrahalaya. It was a small museum that was supposed to have Gandhi's memorabilia, let's say, his letters, and and Nehru wanted a place very close to the Sabarmati Ashram. So there was a site identified there. And Korea was 28 at the time of the competition, 28, 29 at the time of the competition. And what he did was he recognized that Gandhi himself was not an aesthetic man, which means that he did not have a visual per se. But what he had is this, this sense of frugality and sense of complete austerity that was an ideal of sorts, you know. And the second thing I think he recognized is that he was a person of extreme excess. Anybody could reach Gandhi. At the time when he was at the Sabarmati Ashram, it was this is the time of the Satyagraha. It was very natural for people to just sort of meet him in the evening on his prayer meetings, listen to him, ask questions. So this, you know, when you are doing a museum, one of the questions initially were, I think for Korea, what kind of a museum would give access to, or what kind of a museum a common man from a country like India would feel completely comfortable in? It would give access to everybody. And it would have that kind of silent presence in that very iconic campus on which Gandhi's house and his workshop were. So this was the plan, and I think he was very fascinated by the fact that, I can't point here, by the fact that it's a pathway around the building. So it's a single module that's repeated over many times, and there's a sort of parikrama, so to say, a ritualistic pathway that goes around the building, but you can skip that pathway and you can also discover Gandhi in a completely different way every time you go to the building. And when you go, even now, when you visit the building, it's a beautiful building to visit, you can spend a day there, and if you visit still, and you will realize that a lot of these, a lot of people are just there not to look at Gandhi's stuff. They are just there to picnic, sitting around, kids are playing. So it's an extremely accessible building. It just does not, you can imagine a man from the village trying to enter something like the NGMA. You know, there's a lot of intimidation, you know, whether it's for them, not for them, etc. Here everybody walks in. Yeah, that's the section. It's a very nice, very humane section, 2.8 meters to the bottom of the beam. And those sort of roofs that kind of, you know, some of them are courtyards, some of them are. And it's a single module that repeats all over. So it's a fantastically minimal building in that sense. But that's what happens inside, you know. So you can see, you can get these visual connections diagonally and straight. You can see all the way to the river and the bank on the other side, and you have these beautiful courtyards with water and these big concrete channels that pour in. Nice Kadapa floors. It's very warm as a building, it's very humanly scaled, you know, and this floor to beam kind of openings that have that amazing, when you open them, they still operate. I mean, this is like 70 years and they're still in operational completely, and you can see all kinds of people in the museum. You can see intellectuals, you can see businessmen, you can see, you know, common people who just walk in, are curious about what it is. In a way, Gandhi belongs to everyone, you know, and so does the building. Here's something that Nehru said about the building. He said, "You have built here a beautiful museum. Whatever I have seen and done and understood sort of suits this holy place. There is nothing pretentious here. It's a simple and lovely building." That's Nehru with Kasturbai Lalbhai, one of the industrialists who was instrumental in raising funds for the project. A mill owner. That's the model you guys have made. Hindustan Dual Pavilion. Charles Correa and Mahendra Raj, the structural engineer, it was a commission by Hindustan Unilever, which was at that time producing cement. At some point, they wanted a concrete building. And it was done at the Pragati Maidan in Delhi. It was supposed to be a temporary structure, was sort of built by a slip form method. And this also has that wonderful pathway. It is designed to support that idea that the circulation defines the building, and of course the light and the way it is oriented and the way it was oriented and organized, and it was quite an alien looking thing, you know, much before we have people like Daniel Libeskind and all trying to experiment with forms like this. Very difficult to make, made in a very short time, and he also thinks that he must split credit with Mahendra Raj for this building. Mahendra Raj has a beautiful book out, you must get it for the library. It's called The Structure. He's one of the rare structural engineers in India who have kind of worked with everyone, every iconic modern architect we know. Those are some of the working drawings of the building from the archives. You can see how thin the walls are, you know. It was a very difficult building to shape in a very short time. That's how it stood. When you must have seen these images, you have kind of replicated it in your model. Yeah, there's some images from the construction. So you see a very high-tech building being made by a very sort of low-tech means, simple shuttering and scaffolding. The section. Those are some rare images from inside the building when it was built, you know. We were talking about light and how it works in the building. I mean, this is how. It's a very compelling piece of architecture. I wish it would have lasted, but it was just torn down, I think, a month after. I think I skipped a slide. No. Yeah, a simple sketch that, and remember this sketch, it will reoccur in many, many of his buildings. It's a simple idea that a parallel bay building, the way it treats its section, can actually allow air to pass through it. It can cool the ground. It can create a sort of a shaft which pulls air up and a small passage for the air to escape, and that's all you need to passively cool a structured building. So this is one of the sections, very, very rudimentary sketch, translated into another of his early buildings, the tube house. For 36 years, one family, this was built as a prototype, but a family stayed in it for 36 years. It was torn down about half a decade back. And it was supposed to be an entire colony, and what they did was, Charles Collier wanted to demonstrate that the density that you can stack up in the building at the back, the kind of stuff that they ended up making in the same site, can easily be created in a very narrow, very compact building like this, you know, with everybody having access to the ground. And he said that he believed that the access to ground is fundamental to architecture. That you must have in some form, even in Kanchenjunga, you would see that the sense of sky and the sense of ground. The tube house was supposed to be that. It's a beautiful small building. Again, you can see the sketch and how it translates into the section. It's very clear. It has a simple courtyard. It has the services at the back. And it has a split level, a place to sleep, some privacy. These are some of the working drawings. It was built very simply and very frugally, very little, I mean, at that time. He also demonstrated that buildings like this can be built for the same density at very little cost, very little cost. Look at that. It was that narrow. And look at the buildings around, you know. That was supposed to be the scheme, where a lot of these kind of stagger and stack up around a courtyard. And that was some of the images from inside. You know, you have a small window seat. If you close the window, you still have ventilation from below the seat. You have a small window right next to it. You gently steps up. And goes, that little staircase takes you to the loft. From the right, on the left, you go to the courtyard. The loft overlooks the courtyard. The courtyard then leads to the service spaces at the back. There's one of the recent images before it was torn down. We are trying to recreate, I mean, with the foundation, Nandita and all are trying to push SEPT to recreate the block as is, trying to raise funds to see if we can build it again the way it was intended. That was the kind of site it had when it was built. Now it is all sort of built over. And the same idea then kind of translates into a building for a rather rich person, a comparatively rich person, let's say. This is, you know, what he called the summer and the winter section. The summer section kind of interlocks with the winter sections. All these terraces form the winter section where you would want to stay in more sun, you should want to get the light right in, you want to have more, you know, sort of connection with the sky. While in summer, those spaces are very harsh so that you recede into the other part of the section, which is inside. So you can see those sort of yin-yang relationship. And the courtyard kind of becomes a perpetual mediator between the two sections. One of the early study models. He was his own client in this case. This was Korea House, which never got built. It was supposed to be in Ahmedabad. They bought a small piece of land where they were trying to build this, but then they moved to Bombay, so this never got built. But yeah, you can now see the summer winter, you know, what winter does and how the light comes in. And in summer, how it sort of reverses, you know, a small aperture. So it's very controlled and very cozy inside that room, you can imagine. A very simple idea that you have a box and you have a sort of a false roof above the box. You lift the roof. The roof kind of helps you mediate the, kind of negotiate that harsh sun, and you create a breezeway between the brisole or sort of pergolas of the roof and the box. And finally, that becomes the... So this particular study section became an inspiration for many projects to come. The Ramakrishna House for one of the mill owners in Ahmedabad. So this is another thing that I noticed about Korea, that irrespective of whether he was building for rich, for extremely rich in this case, one of the richest people in the country at that time, to the tube house for middle class, lower middle class workers, blue collar people, the idea sort of fluidly moves across, you know. So there's no pretension in the fact that, you know, let me do some tricks because I have more budget. Or it's as simple and as clear to him that irrespective of whom he is building, I mean, the quality of architecture does not change. So at the same kind of cost per square feet, really. Ramakrishna House, again, doesn't exist anymore. But a similar idea. I'll run through this project quickly because it doesn't, you can study them. This is in the books. You would have Housing and Urbanization, that little book in the library. I think that's from where all these images and all have come. That was the Ramakrishna House. A kind of extended version of the tube house or the Korea house, you know, a kind of study in the same section. Privy. So the mayor of this town in Peru was an architect, and he instituted a competition inviting architects from around the world to build housing in a certain budget with a certain density. Six architects were chosen of the competition. One of them was Charles Correa. This is the first time Charles Correa was building abroad. So it got him a lot of attention internationally. This was also when he must be 34, 35. The housing still exists, by the way. It has changed beyond recognition, but some of the units are still the same, I will show. So it was a simple interlock. As you can see, the courtyard stagger, the houses go front and back. It was a simple, and because of this change of wall, you don't have to do columns, you know. It becomes very strong by itself because you fold it. It's a folded plate, and then it has its own rigidity. So in a very thin concrete plate, you can actually avoid columns, which saves a lot of cost. That was the Privy when it was under construction. So that was the overall scheme. A lot of different architects have had their particular plots, large plots in the scheme, and you can see the Charles Corey housing at the top, at the left, the top left. And there are other architects as well who eventually, even Christopher Alexander for that matter. So that's a nice meeting with Charles Correa. You can see the young Charles Correa, second to left, and then you skip two, and that's Christopher Alexander. That's and that's the and what you cannot see on this side, whom you cannot see, is Richard Meyer. So it's a very unique photograph of this meeting that happened for this project. The courtyard, the little staircase that takes you up, and look at the thinness of that wall, and the way the coffered slab reduces the use of concrete, and it had these beautiful large spans. Again, for the very sort of, those were images of the site when it was under construction. You can see the interlocking walls being constructed there. The way they stack up, the first level in the ground. Yeah. A brilliant case study for, you know, low-rise, high-density housing. A similar idea then kind of is explored at Belapur. This is very close to you. You must visit. Some of these old houses are still intact. You can see the trace of them. Over the time, Belapur has been built over. It has... The context has taken in, but what has remained of the original plan are the open spaces, and this is something that was very important to Korea, is the exact dimension and the quality of open space around which you build, because the buildings, especially in housing, will change. People will take, and that's a sign of good housing, that it's malleable. You know, people are able to change it beyond recognition. The way they want, the way their families grow, the change the paint slowly, add a room here and there. And the housing that allows that is the sign of good housing. So Belapur now, if you go, it's beyond recognition. You know, you don't really realize. It's called Artist's Village, if you ever go to Belapur. But some of these old, the grain survives, the exact way in which the open spaces are organized and all that Charles Correa intended to organize it in a certain way, they all survive. So it's a simple thing. It's almost like fractals. I don't know if you know fractals. At any level of magnification, the plan looks pretty similar. And you can see that one module, the way it kind of repeats itself over a larger module, and the way the larger modules come together and create a ecosystem around. So there's a hierarchy of open spaces, from community to neighborhood to, you know, sort of set of four houses sharing a small courtyard. And there were five types, depending on how you can just go from, just a shed and a small toilet to. So it was a part of sites and services experiment as well, but it had great quality built into it. There's other sites and services experiments, especially like with from other Indian architects, were kind of, they had that element of being able to deploy housing quickly and cheaply and efficiently, but lacked that sense of quality and humanness that Belapur has, I think. Just some images to give you a sense of the quality of open space when it was built. Beautiful set of courtyards and little balconies, and the relationship between built and open and the neighborhoods. Yeah, you can see it from a recent satellite image. is built over, but you can see the beautiful, the magic of what Charles Correia attempted to do. And you can see the sequence of built open spaces that kind of meander into the fabric of the built. And it's still like this. The good thing is that the open spaces have stayed, because in terms of ownership, nobody owns them. So nobody has the incentive to change them beyond. So of course now some cars you'll see around and all, but one of our students went and did this set of images very recently. So you can see the green of what Charles Correia, some of these old buildings which have stayed, along with some of them which have been demolished. That's all fine, because in housing that's inevitable, things will change. But look at the sense of open space, you know, that exact green that Correia imagined, it's beautiful. And you have this amazing green small pockets all around Belapur when you go there. It doesn't even feel like you're in Bombay. People sit around and look at that little house that has survived, even the roof that has survived, and then somebody has made a sort of a three-floor housing, which is fine. So the new landscape, one of his very first and very seminal books, a set of essays that he had authored in 1971, 72, I think, had this set of rules, let's say, a code for housing. It said incrementality, housing must be able to grow. Open to sky space, every resident must have access to the sky. Equity, housing must not be built by a single big brute developer, that what's happening right now. It must give employment to a lot of people, and a lot of small people can gain out of it. So it builds equity into it. It is not sort of some whatever, some big developer comes and deploys that kind of housing that now everybody buys at 22 lakhs. That's not how he imagined housing to be. Desegregation, that means that it is not a single agency that is employed in building of housing. Many agencies are employed, you know, from artisans like carpenters and all the way to developers, including developers. Pluralism, yes, housing cannot be monolithic. We cannot have in a country like India, which is deeply secular, with supposed to be deeply secular, not anymore, I think, which is very diverse and things like that. I think it's important that housing is the primary grain that builds in this pluralism. You must share your walls with people who of completely different ethnicity and values. Then only you are able to or assimilate the life of what a citizen is supposed to do in a country like India. I don't think we have that anymore. We are we create more and more walls and gates and get trapped into. So every time we build those societies with gates and watchmen, we trap ourselves in as much as we keep others out. That's also something to remember. And malleability, people must be able to change housing. Participation, a lot of people must be able to gain employment, give employment through housing, and income generation, this is important. Which means that any housing which is very far from sources of income, small sources of income, Bombay that way is unique. The grain of housing in Bombay is so much intertwined with commerce that, you know, you have these small shops and mom and pop kind of establishments that are kind of woven with housing. It is not so much as new developments. Let's say if you go to Gurgaon or Delhi and all, you know, you have this strange binary. You live in a housing and then you go to work and then you go to a mall, and then it's just alienating. And it's very alienating, especially to people who cannot afford any of it. Bombay, somehow, the way it is messily designed, builds in that equity. And I think he understood, that's why he loved this city so much. No other city has this level of integration. You can almost imagine Bombay to be a microcosm of what India is supposed to be. Very quickly, this is... So in a lot of Charles Correia's work, you will see a lot of these unbuilt works have threads of ideas that eventually... So if just keep in mind Kanchanjunga apartments when you are looking at these slides. This is boys' houses, unbuilt, designed for a family in Pune. You see that interlocking section? It's a small step-up apartment. But just remember this section, the way it interlocks. Very simple diagram. Again, another unbuilt project in Bombay, the Cosmopolis. Almost 2 decades before Kanchenjunga, Korea was thinking about that section. He wanted a project in which he can experiment with that idea. So he tried that in Cosmopolis, it didn't work. But you can see now slowly the Kanchenjunga section evolving. And then of course Kanchenjunga. You know this building, I'm not going to spend time on this. It's right here in Bombay. It's an incredibly complex one and difficult to, so good, you've made a model so you have better understanding of what it is. There it is. It still stands quite distinct from everything in the neighborhood. Nothing, I don't think any other building in Bombay has this sort of respectable silent presence. And it's all because of that one singular idea that was developed almost 20 years before this building in the boys' houses. That's Nandita, his daughter, who is sort of modeling for the photograph. And the same Kanchenjunga section kind of becomes very important for him when he is also developing housing for Mahada. This is housing for the poor. It'll fix itself. I hope. Yep. Almost there. So even here, because of the split level, you get this double height, community spaces. And this is very important to him, because in Bombay, it's inevitable that you stack densities. Now especially, you can't justify building to the ground. The kind of housing that we saw in Belapur is a very different time. But even when you are stacking densities, he was very concerned about how people at different levels, no matter which floor they are staying, will have places to gather. We'll have, where will the kids play, where will the nannies be, where will the grandmom sit, and stuff like that. So you can see in his schemes, this beautiful double height, middle height spaces, and the skip stop elevators, so elevators which stop every third floor. Because in a low cost housing, one of the most difficult components to maintain and to install is the elevator. Because it's a shared resource, and anything that is shared resource in low cost is sort of difficult in principle. As a component. So yeah, so this is one of the skip stop elevators, enabled by the skip stop elevator, this beautiful sort of open space in the sky. Yep, there it is. So at any level you have to climb half a stair up or half a stair down to access this common space. That's the beauty of this housing. Another seminal book, Housing and Urbanization. You must have this in your library, I think. And Vistar. One of the things that Charles Koya did, apart from doing architecture, is also his invaluable contribution to culture. And one of the first exhibitions in 1985, Pupil Jaikar and Indira Gandhi commissioned the Festival of India. It was a huge exhibition that traveled across the world, talked about India from different perspectives. One of the parts was architecture, and two different firms, Charles Koria's firm and Raj Rival's firm, were commissioned to do these exhibitions. They traveled different places. While Raj Rival's firm talked about proportions, history in a very linear sort of way, Charles Koria took a different route. He said, what are the core ideas that govern the architecture of India? And not just India as in now, the India of history. So they went all the way from the rivers to the caves of Ajanta and all, and that look for critical ideas that are still relevant that you must talk about when you talk about the architecture of India. So this is Vistar. It talked about the Jantar Mantar, it talked about Corbusier. This two different, completely, bisymmetrical worlds. Over time, this obsession with India also reflects in his larger projects, institutional projects like museums, Jawaharlal Kala Kendra, you have seen there. This is the National Archaeology Museum, which never got built. But you can see the traces of the plan of what the JKK became or what the National Crafts Museum is in this diagram. It's a beautiful diagram. And again, what he was very insistent on is a clear understanding of the open space. He said the rooms around the open space do not matter too much because you don't perceive it like that. But if the open space is clearly defined and the scale of it is correct, then you kind of read the building very differently. So that's the essay called The Empty Center. The scale of the open space in the Archaeology Museum again never got built. He was so clear about these ideas. You look at the courtyard, you know, perfectly square, beautiful sense of arrival. But the rooms around, yes, of course, they are not very defined yet. Eventually, the courtyard becomes a central idea and the rooms kind of are secondary to the principle. The same thing happens in the Bharat Bhavan, one of the most beautiful buildings I've ever been to in Bhopal. It's what he calls a non-building. I mean, if you go there, if you try to go there and try photographing Bharat Bhavan, you don't know how to capture that building in photographs because it is not there. It's just these platforms leading to the river and the entire building is sort of below the platforms. And you only experience the terraces and these little staircases that go down. So that's the essential diagram of the building. You don't know where it is. It's completely sort of below the surface. Look at that, different courtyards. And that's the thing about his buildings, you know, they are completely accessible. They're egalitarian in that sense. They do not have a class of people who can access them. Even though they are built for the rich, some of them, even though they are built for a certain genre of society, like the museums and the galleries, but you will always find children and common man and people having picnic who have nothing to do with the exhibition inside, who are just there because it's a beautiful building to sort of have that gesture to the river. Bharat Bhavan is a classic example of that. Look, yeah, there is no building, you know. When you enter, you see all the way to the river and you don't know where to go, all over the place. That's a kind of essential section of a courtyard. And you, of course, know the Jawahar Kala Kendra. I'll skip through these quickly. The nine planets and the one kind of symbolically resolves. Yeah, one of the deeper layers of Charles Currier's work is also the layer of the metaphor, you know. The implied gestures to the cosmic ideas. So this is the Navagraha, I think the nine planets and the one in the center. And because the grid of Jaipur is also organized around the nine planets. But because of the hill, the one sort of planet moves. So he kind of gestures that with that movement of that square. So it had a lot of, his work has a lot of intellectual content, which kind of, as you go deeper and deeper into his work, it becomes more and more apparent to you. See? It's a spectacular building. It's one of the. It's unfortunate that our obsession with air conditioning now has kind of killed some of these projects. Now they put some glass, and these courtyards are not accessible anymore because people just are not used to the heat in Jaipur anymore. They want a very sort of. Everybody expects everything to work like a mall now. So. If you don't enter a gate in which you have this blast of air conditioning that hits you, you don't feel very happy about that incident. So somehow they have managed to do air condition some parts of it. Of course, some of it was necessary, I understand, but some of it is quite ridiculous. This is again Nandita, a couple of years later, modeling for the photograph. Each of the planets, the way it is organized around the courtyard. This beautiful artwork all around the building. They're trying to maintain these. It's difficult because the color changes over time. Very quickly, I'll go through this. Dayuka in Pune. Again, it's a laboratory. It's one of the most one of the 37 constituent laboratories of the country, which involves itself in fundamental research. It is the kind of scientists who give us the everything from renewable energy to nuclear bombs. But people who work, the research that happens behind these rooms is that important and that significant. And so you have these beautiful statues of Einstein looking at the sky and all. It's a little exaggerated in that little courtyard, granites. Again, the value of the open space, you know, is immeasurable. This is a little extension to the same Ayuka campus, the housing for the faculty. It's quite beautiful. I'll go through this very quickly. Some of his office buildings, some of his workspaces, just to sort of give you a sense of that other side of Korea's work. This is the MIT Cognitive Sciences Institution at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, one of the most critical laboratories in the world at the cutting edge of research on brain and how we think. So it has a hermetically sealed laboratory, and there is a railway line, a tram line that passes through the site. So the way he negotiates that, it's very interesting. And that's Charles Courier's building on the right, and that thing on the left that you see is Frank Gehry. So what Charles Courier says is that because Frank Gehry was building on the street, the decibel level of the street was very high, you know, is because Frank Gehry is like that, he's flamboyant and loud and inconsiderate to a great degree. On the other side, this Korea building sort of brings down the decibel level. You know, it's a simple building that increases the sort of stature of the street, that gives back to, it has a certain quietitude, you know, so it's not like shouting at you, while the building on the left clearly is trying to gain all the attention you have in the world. So that's the kind of this beautiful image that is also to me emblematic of what is happening in our cities right now. You know, we have too many buildings like the kind on the left, which are all the time shouting at you, trying to get your attention, doing all sorts of tricks, juggleries and stuff. And somehow that has become the kind of architecture that we all appreciate. But if that's too much of it, I don't know how overstimulated we are. On the other side, this beautiful silent edifices that we had over the sort of, let's say, till 20 years back, are kind of lost in the city now. You know, they don't have. And if you see in Bombay also, you have this beautiful life insurance corporation buildings and MTNL buildings and all the government, old government buildings, which are kind of very respectable silent edifices. Yeah, that's the case in point. We should move. You can study the sections, but the good thing, see, look at the section, you know, the open space kind of has this amazing connection all the way to the top. So anywhere you are, and that little tram that goes to the basement, that's the building, that's the open space inside. This building is, like I said, hermetically sealed. It's restricted to most, because it's the material and the research component laboratories there are extremely high-tech, so very few people can really operate, and scientists and research physicists and all work in these labs. But they also get this opportunity to use that double height corners, hang around a little bit, you know, try to go across, meet somebody by chance in this internal space, and that's the train going through the building. It's a spectacular moment if you're there. And suddenly the building shakes a little, and just you see every time the train passes this little vibration in the building, and it's part of that whole idea of being in that building. So he talks about trains in his A Place in the Shade, another seminal book that you must have, and his love for this, I don't know, people older than me remember this sort of tin tracks that you put together, and you create these different configurations in which those those trains that move on keys, that winding trains that used to run. So these were at some point manufactured by a company called Hornby. They are not around anymore. That's the Charles Collier Foundation, a small building in Panjim, where I worked in this building for about, I had the good fortune to work in this building for about 2.5 years. Ah, crap. Very, go back. So very quickly, what the foundation does is it kind of tries to contribute to, through architecture and through urban design research, to what's happening in Goa. So one of the things that we have taken up is to improve the kind of Anganwadis that our kids go to. And who are these kids? There are kids whose parents cannot afford private institutions like the one we are sitting in. These are children of workers, of milkmen, and of the blue collar, category of a lot of migrant workers. Children go to the Anganwadis, deal with children between 2 and 6 years of age. So it's a very critical time where nutrition and cognitive development happens, and you need monitoring of how the child is doing. And look at the condition in which our Anganwadis are run, and they are fully subscribed. I don't know whether you've been to one. And they are supposed to be placed very close to the neighborhood. So even in 100 meters of that building, there'll be a couple of Anganwadis that you don't know of. So you may want to go and visit them. So one of the things is what kind of infrastructure we are giving our own children, whom we expect to kind of lead our nation for the next 30 years to come. That's Panjim. So Sachin, who had done one of the previous, has worked on this project with the foundation. He was one of the lead architects to develop this small prototype Anganwadi, which has this nice open play space in the center, and all the rooms occupy the four corners. It's a very simple design, and that's and one of the early diagrams of this particular building when we evolved was made by Mr. Korea. I think the building got completed after he passed away. He could not see it, but he was very vigilant about the process of even this little thing that we were developing, Very recently we did an exhibition at the Max Müller Bauern Gallery on the unbuilt works of Charles Collier, because we felt that a lot of his, almost 33% of all the projects that were in the archives were not built for different reasons. But this, like you saw in the case of the Cosmopolis and the Kanchenjunga, these buildings with the wealth of unbuilt projects have this incredible repository of ideas that can be taken forward. So this little catalog, the unbuilt works of Charles Collier, that's also available at the foundation, I think, and talks about these ideas. And that was the exhibition. That was the whole timeline of his career. And you can see that long thing there. That's the assembly building. It took 17 years to build one building. He had patience to see through a building for 17 years. And it was more of a study exhibition. I don't know, some of you must have been there. It was just these tables where the portfolios were kept. You can just spend an entire day looking at his work. A lot of footfalls. So this is the last essay in that book, which is called The Snail Trail, which is one of the last essays he had written, which talks about this, how a snail kind of leaves behind a trail when it kind of slithers on the floor. So just like a snail, he said that an architect also has this trail of ideas that he leaves behind. Some of them may not be sort of resurrected, but some of them are so compelling that they come feature again and again if you are that kind of a cultural practitioner that he was. He wasn't just an architect. He wrote, he lectured, he taught, he had a deep connection to philosophy and film. He had an incredible affinity towards films. He has made more than 6 films in his career. So that way his work resembles a certain culture of architecture that we kind of find missing in newer institutions. And how do you inculcate that culture, is by creating these, by letting people remember that as they walk, they leave behind this trail, and these ideas that are trapped in this trail are very important. For the students, I think it's very critical to understand from where I come, is that Charles Goodyear's ideas are very accessible, whether he's around or not is secondary. It is important, and his texts are also very clear. They are not shrouded in sort of intellectual jargon and all. It's very, very clearly written text. It is important to see if you can not just kind of look at his work critically and try and evaluate how your work kind of reflects. We all have to find our own way. But what is important is to understand the core concerns that he had as an architect. You know, to deal with an India in a certain way, an India which, as we spoke at the beginning, is deeply secular, is pluralistic, and to resist this temptation of creating monoliths. Monoliths like malls and multiplexes and all, where a certain class of people can enter, how do you make, even when he was commissioned to do the mall in Kolkata, he kind of broke that whole thing, and which is now one of the most vibrant public places in Kolkata. This is that city center. And it was completely, the developers, Ambuja Neotia, who were part of that whole idea, were very skeptical of this thing that, everybody will come in, so what? And now it is one of the most successful malls in Kolkata, the only mall he ever did. So one of my personal learnings from Korea is that, you must be critical on yourself, about what you accept as commissions, about the kind of people you deal with. And you also must be rigorous, so I think being rigorous and being critical. Yep. Is the last project he really loved, the Shyam Palimar. You have a model there. Those are the two concrete columns that we talked about. And that's the water body. See, that's the water body. We are only as big as the questions we address. And this, to my mind, is the central riveting fact of life architects in the third world. We are the architects in the third world. Not the size or the value of projects that we are working on, but the nature of questions they raise, and which we must confront. A chance to grow, an abiding virtue of a place in the sun. Thank you.
Thank you, Rituraj. Please be seated. And welcoming Mr. Ashish Mishraji and Aditya Mishraji, please come on the dais. A round of applause. Thank you once again, Architect Rituraj, for your thoughts, sharing your experiences with the legendary architect. And I definitely believe the students will take a great advantage of this. Hope the students can imbibe, understand the concerns, what is prevalent in our country today, and devise innovative solutions for the same from this lecture series. Now, it's a time for celebrations, rewards, and I would like to call upon Architect Tripti Biswas to announce the awardees.
Thank you, Varsha. My warm greetings to all present over here. I take this opportunity to extend my gratitude towards architect Rituraj Parekh today for his presence amongst us, and which has definitely added a lot of value to the gathering today. This association with architect Charles Goodyear's works and his willingness to spend time with us today to share his valuable insights on Goodyear's ideologies is definitely going to help us carve out better studio methodologies. We had been lucky that we had architect Narendra Dengle in 2016 when we started Charles Goodyear Memorial Lecture Series, and followed by architect Ajay Sachin Agashikar, and today the presence of architect Rituraj Parekh. Marking this day at our institute, by making it also a day of excellence in design awards for our students since 2016 has helped us also to reassure that it brings in quality and intensity in our design studios. Such awards keep us, faculties and students inspired to do more meaningful work. So with this, I would like to announce the design awards for the academic years 2018-19 and 19-20. So today I feel privileged and honored to stand over here in front of you and acknowledge the achievements of our brilliant students who have both made the school and the parents proud. These students exhibit such qualities that will not only help them in achieving their goals, but also bring glory and success to our institute. We are gathered here not just to celebrate the achievements of these students, but also to give due regard to our values and morals which such awardees exemplify, like discipline, compassion, and the zeal of learning, and as Rituraj rightly pointed out, the rigorousness that we need. We acknowledge the talent of our dreaming buddies, and to begin with the prize distribution ceremony, I would like to invite Architect Rituraj Parekh to felicitate the students of the year 2017-18 and 18-19. So I call upon the first award, which goes to our fifth year student Vidhi Sanghvi, 2017-18. The topic of her thesis was Intergenerational Habitat, a Catalyst of Social Connections and Urban Regeneration. Vidhi Sanghvi, Architect Vidhi Sanghvi. We invite Ashish sir and Aditya sir to be on the dais for to share the photograph, please. Also, Rita ma'am, please. So big round of applause. For the year 2017-18, the Semester 6 University Design Semester Award for Excellence in Design goes to Leela Jain. The project was Cultural Habit Manvi Bhuj. May I request Shri Ashish Mishra sir to please give the award to our student. A big round of applause, guys. Next we have the Academic Awards for the year 19-20, wherein the Semester 6 Award goes to Shivani Durkunde. The design topic was redefining the ethos of heritage. Third year, Semester 6, Shivani Durkunde. Big round of applause, please. We have Aditya sir, if you could please give us the opportunity of being with a student. Thank you so much, sir. The current academic year's Best Thesis Design Award for final year goes to Anand Shah, the topic being Ahmedabad, Revitalizing a Heritage Precinct Through Urban Inserts. May I request Rituraj Parekh, sir, to please come on stage. So we have Architect Anand Shah, the Best Design Pieces Award for the year. He's also scored a complete CGPA of 10. So a big round of applause for him. Thank you so much. I would like to request Varsha to continue with the proceedings further.
Thank you so much, Shruti ma'am, for encouraging the students. And we now conclude this memorable journey celebrating the legendary architect. I would like to say well done to those who have received the honors and the awards. And to the rest of the students, I would say you can be the next. In the end, I would like to use this wonderful opportunity to thank Ashish Mishraji, Aditya Mishraji, our guest of honor, Architect Rituraj Parekh, Principal Architect Rita Nayak, and Tripti Biswas for creating these awards to encourage students and provide them a distinct path to follow. A special word of thanks also to the second yearites for creating the models and showcasing the Charles Correia work. And a special thanks to all my fellow colleagues and other students for joining us and making this occasion a great success.
One photograph, just request them to come together.
I would request all the awardees to please come on the dais with, to have a photograph with the dignitaries. Anand Shah, Hina Jain,
Students, we all go back to our classes right now.